Hello, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon where you are. I'm delighted to welcome Ebba Koch from the University of Vienna. She received her DPhil in the History of Art and Classical Architecture from the University of Vienna in Austria in 86. She has taught as a visiting professor at Oxford and Harvard and was a senior researcher at the Austrian Academy of Sciences and the Tagore National Fellow for Cultural Resource under the Indian Ministry of Culture, 2015-17. She has conducted major surveys of Mughal architecture in the Indian subcontinent. Her other research interests are Mughal painting and applied art, the political, social, and symbolic meaning of art, and the artistic connections between the Mughals and their neighbors and Europe. She's published widely on these topics. Her major publications include Mughal Architecture, 1991 and then 2014, Mughal Art and Imperial Ideology, 2001, The Complete Taj Mahal and the Riverfront Gardens of Agra, 2006, and then again in 2012, and is co-author with M.C. Beach, King of the World, the Padishahnameh, an imperial Mughal manuscript from the Royal Library, Windsor Castle, in 1997. Most recently, she's edited, together with Ali Anushah, the collected volume, The Mughal Empire from Jahangir to Shah Jahan, and that is in 2019. Ebba, the floor is, if there is such a thing as a floor in this kind of environment, the floor is now yours.
So, right, so, yeah, once more, thank you, Andrew, for introducing me, and generally, I thank the British Institute of Persian Studies for the invitation to present here today my new book, The Planetary King, Humayun Pasha, Inventor and Visionary on the Mughal Throne, which should be out soon, inshallah, and with the publisher Mappin in Ahmedabad. Now, of all the great Mughals, Humayun, the son of Babur and the second Mughal ruler, is perhaps the least understood and appreciated. He is remembered chiefly as a political and military failure, having lost to his rival, the Afghan Sher Shah, what Babur had conquered in India. Humayun is mainly known through the magnificent mausoleum at Delhi, which was raised by his son Akbar between 1562 and 71. And in the past years, the Aga Khan Trust for Culture in India has been building a site museum for the tomb, which you you see here, the top, it's underground. You see the top here on the right side. So, and I was invited to assist with developing a program for the permanent exhibition. A major focus is on the ruler for whom the tomb was created. So here we have the underground view of the galleries still in progress, and here a portrait of Humayun. So the major focus is on him, to shed light on his travels, campaigns, extraordinary social and intellectual life, and his deep involvement with the knowledge systems of his time, with the sciences of mathematics, astronomy, astrology, and occultism, and with literature, poetry, painting, and architecture. To accompany the permanent exhibition, I wrote this book, in which I attempt to draw a picture of Humayun's life and works, and especially to reconstruct the extraordinary inventions that he had described by his historian Ghiyasuddin Khandamir, namely the planetary organization of his court, his extravagant buildings and court settings, and in the last part, I consider Humayun's tomb as a posthumous realization of his ideas and dreams. Now, for my talk here today, I would first like to draw attention to some aspects of Humayun's sojourn in Iran, and at the time when he was ousted from Hindustan and had to ask Shah Tahmasp for refuge. In the second part, I shall look at how already before his stay in Iran, In the early 1530s at Agra and Gwalior, Humayun represented himself as a king and reorganized his court by reaching far back into a mythic Iranian past. Now, Humayun was young when he acceded to the Mughal throne, but he was driven by a quest for fame and perceived himself in the eyes of an imagined posterity. However, it was not historiography that would fashion his image, but the products of his intellect, his imagination, and talent that would get him a place in history. But the evidence suggests that Prepacha was too optimistic in his expectations, because Khandamir's text failed to keep Humayun alive in the memory and admiration of future generations. Now, to reconstruct a richer history of Humayun, we are better served when we turn to retrospective sources, which were written during the time of his son and successor, Akbar. And these narratives allow us to place Humayun in his times, to understand the challenges he had to face in the transition between his perceived Timurid homelands, Afghanistan, Iran, and India, when he had to negotiate his position with his brothers, Amirs, and Beks, who constantly wavered in their loyalty. These were not halcyon years, but he prevailed over them as a highly intellectual individual, and it is true that no other Mughal emperor quite matched any of these abilities. But these rich qualities were part of the 16th century, the qualities of a time that might have been lost but for Humayun. So we shall now enter Humayun's history. It's the first part of the book where I give a survey of Humayun's life and travels. So I would like to take you to Iran when, he decided what seemed to for him the last resort, namely to apply to the Shah of Iran, when he had reached Gamsir at the banks of the river Helmand. He sent a letter to Shah Tahmasp on 28th December 1543, asking for his help and hospitality. So the Shah realized that the prestige he would earn by protecting a descendant of Timur and Pasha of Hindustan, and replied with a letter in which he extended a warm welcome and dispatched firmans to the governors of all the provinces through which his guest would pass on his way to the capital in the northwest of Iran, to Qazvin. But Humayun expressed first his wish to see Herat, and the last capital of the Timurid Empire. And here he got a great reception by the governor Muhammad Khan, who had been given instructions by Shah Tahmasp in an amazingly detailed letter. So here Humayun visited the gardens and buildings of Iran and the shrine of the saints, especially the shrine of Khaja Abdullah Ansari at Gaswagar. And here he might have even stayed in this octagonal pavilion called today Namakdam, which could give him the idea for his own polygonal pavilion when he returned to Delhi in 1555, which you see here on the right side. So from Herat, the Pasha set out from Mashhad via Durvadishik Jam, which had a special meaning for him. So here was the shrine of the famous saint Abdullah. The Sheikh Ahmed Jam, who was a famous theologian and religious teacher known as Thunder Peel, the colossal elephant, who was also the ancestor of Humayun's mother, Mahan Begum, and his wife, Hamida Begum. And on his way out of Jam, he left the inscription there, to which I shall return later. Then at Mashhad, he got a letter from the Shah asking him to move on, and then moved across the north of Iran, where Nishapur, Sabzawar, Damghan, Bistam, and Simnan, where he visited the shrines of famous saints. And Abul Fasl, Akbar's historian, notes that these visits were to pray the saints for assistance in his difficult situation. On the way, Humayun was asked to send Bayram Khan forward as an ambassador to arrange with the Shah how the two monarchs should meet. And when the Shah asked Bayram to cut his hair and put on the Safavid headgear, Setache Haidari, he refused to do so. Now in July or August 1544, Humayun arrived at Qazvin, and from there he moved on to meet the Shah himself. And when the two rulers met face to face, Shah Tahmasp received Humayun with honor and held a much lease for him. But then the Shah insisted that Humayun should wear the Shia Taji Haidari, which consisted of a red conical head topped by a baton. Should I take this off? Yeah. By a baton. And around which was wrapped a white turban with 12 folds commemorating the 12 Imams. Now Humayun tried to find a way out and replied by playing on the double meaning of the word. Okay. Now this doesn't move forward anymore. What happened? Oh, so share screen. I'm sorry, we got interrupted. So right, here we are. So this is to show you what Humayun was trying to tell the Shah, that he would be proud to wear the crown, but he would consider it as Taji Isad, which was a headdress he had himself introduced as Mughal court dress after his accession, and as Barodi and as Asfar Muin suggested, already in response to the Taji Haidari. It was it had two elements here, which should represent the number 7, because Isad in Abshad reckoning corresponds to the number 77. So anyway, the Shah got annoyed with Humayun and wanted to leave for Sultaniyye, and before that Humayun represented him a visit, but he was received very coldly and followed the Shah to Sultaniyye and sat then in the great tomb of in the mausoleum of Sultan El-Chaiti and found himself a prey to Weltschmerz and self-pity, bemoaning his fate and wished he had not come to Iran. And the Shah increased the pressure on Humayun to adopt the Shia and threatened to kill him and his followers, and thus Humayun had to give in. Now there is some doubt, you know, how Humayun sort of committed himself to the sheer faith. His servant Zohar writes about it. But a Quran, which was dedicated by Humayun about a year later to the shrine of Ardabil, makes quite an unambiguous statement by beginning with the praise of the 14 infallibles, the Prophet Muhammad and his daughter Fatima, and the 12 Imams. So here we have the dedication of Humayun. So if we go back to August 1544, then the Shah relaxed his attitude to some degree and that he would help the Mughal Padshah to recover Kandahar, Kabul and Badakhshan by supplying him with 12,000 men under the nominal command of his third son, Mirza Murad, who was then still an infant, and the actual command of Budak Khan Qajar. Then he invited Humayun to hunt with him near Taht Suleiman, after which the two rulers to clear from each other and Humayun moved on to Tabriz. Here he spent his days with sightseeing and watched the games of wolf running, Gurd Davani, and hockey, Jogan Balsi, for which the city was famous. These entertainments had been banned to prevent rioting, but to please Humayun, a royal order had been given for them to be held again. And judging from two illustrations made for the Aspaname some 50 years after the event, wolf running meant that the beasts were set on men, perhaps prisoners or slaves, and encouraged by the handlers to attack them. In a way, it recalls the venationes, the wild beast hunts of ancient Rome, and that Humayun enjoyed watching this cruel game reveals a less sensitive side of his character. From Tabriz, Humayun went to Ardabil, and according to a tradition, the historicity of which is difficult to evaluate, Humayun made offerings at the shrine as a sign of gratitude for Safavid assistance at the tombs of Sheikh Safiuddin and Shah Ismail. And this tradition can be traced back to James Justinian Maurier, who wrote in 1818 that Humayun donated a gold ewer and, I quote, a very beautiful casement of fine work, like mosaics composed of ivory, tortoiseshell, and turquoises, inlaid with passages from the Quran. End of quote. So this highly artistic work has been associated by Alexander Morton in an article in Iran with similar, so less fine, wooden tomb covers in Ardabil, and one of which is signed by a craftsman from Maragay. So if Humayun did indeed sponsor this work, he commissioned it from a local craftsman. So from here, he moved via Mashhad again to Turbat-e Sheikh Jam, where he left an inscription which is dated 29th December 1544, and which testifies to his second visit to the shrine. So anyway, I'm not reading it out. I hope you have seen it right now. And so the slab is partly broken and the inscription is hardly legible. It's written in black ink in Nastaliq style, It's today displayed in a glass case in the shrine next to a case which contains an illuminated Quran of Aurangzeb. So here from Charm, Humayun went to Sistan, where he held a review of his troops. And from there, he set out for Kandahar and entered the territories controlled by his brother Kamran. Altogether, he had spent about a year in Iran, which is much less than generally believed, and he met the Shah only off and on between July and autumn, leaving Safavid territory in December of that year, namely 1544. Now, it has been held by several scholars, including myself, that it was Humayun's stay in Iran which inspired him in his formulation of kingship and in the extraordinary organization of his court and his imaginative court settings. However, according to Handamir and Akbar, Humayun seems to have thought about his destiny and rule in relationship also to Iran much earlier, as a useful regent in Badakhshan, and he began to realize his ideas as soon as the political situation allowed it after he came to the Mughal throne in Agra in 1530. The foundation of his rule was an So it was a new organization of his court according to cosmic categories and new interactive settings designed to break up conventional hierarchies and conventional rituals to restructure court society. He reached far back into a mythic past and reinvented tradition to bring into play new forms of social interaction for his newly assembled heterogeneous elite. His erudition, paired with a humanistic personality, led him to imagine a visionary draft of a utopian society favored by the heavens, not in a traditional religious sense, but by tapping into the positive energies of the astrological planets. The anchor of the project was a grouping of all of his subjects into three classes. The Ehle Daulat were the people of power, then the Ehle Murad were the learned, the educated, and the religious, and the Ehle Murad were the entertainers. And with these three groups, Humayun set out to engage the cosmic powers for his court and adapted esoteric planetary knowledge for his own purposes to attract and draw down beneficial planetary influences on himself and his court. He conducted administrative and court business with the subgroups of the main groups on particular days of the week, according to their planetary connection. And the sympathetic relationship between the planets and his court was established through their colors. The colors of Humayun's planets corresponded to those with the Persian poet Nizami Ganjavi associated with the planets in his tale Hafpekar, and he seems to have followed here the traditions going back to the planetary cult of the Sabaeans of Haran in Upper Mesopotamia, which is today in Turkey, and which are this planetary cult, which is connected to the 7-day week, which had survived from Assyrian times. So Humayun matched the color of his dress to the color of the planet of the day to attract this beneficial influence, and he created also specific settings as a stage theater of his new planetary court. An outstanding installation was here the Byzantine Shard, or the Carpet of Mars, a carpet made of valuable material, which represented a scientific cosmogram of the universe that followed the general geocentric scheme of Muslim astronomers. Well, I think we stay here for the time being. back to Ptolemy. An example for this would be a diagram of the planetary spheres in a 15th or 16th century copy of the classic cosmography of Caswini, Ajaib al-Makhlukat, in the Österreichische Nationalbibliothek at Vienna. And I used this as a basis for my reconstruction. So Humayun describes the carpet in detail with its different colored celestial spheres next to one and another in concentric circles like the layers of an onion. So on the outside is a white crystalline sphere, then comes the zodiac, which is not mentioned by Handamir, and then Saturn, black, for Jupiter, sandalwood, fifth is Mars, red, the sixth, the Sun, and the seventh, Venus, which is bright green, the eighth, Mercury, purple, and the ninth, the Moon, white. Then comes the sublunar region with the circles of fire, air, water, and the Earth itself divided into the seven climes. So then Humayun's court had to sit in the circle of the respective planets. And he had, and in a way, the carpet provided the Pacha with a grand stage for his performance as a cosmic king, a sun. He would sit in the circle of the sun as the leader of the planets. Now his carpet as a planispheric cosmogram can be connected with several strands of scientific, literary, and artistic traditions. With his knowledge of astronomy and astrology, Humayun was of course familiar with the Ptolemaic geocentric cosmic model of the circular arrangement of the planetary spheres around the Earth, but the inspiration to use the Ptolemaic model for the realization of his cosmic carpet as a stage for his court clearly goes back to ancient Sasanian concepts, which were handed down in classical Persian literature, with which Humayun was very familiar as a highly educated Timurid prince. In Ferdowsi Shahnameh, we read about the court arrangements of the Sasanian king Khusro II Parviz. In particular, the famous throne called Takhtis, or throne of veneration. According to Ferdowsi, the Takhtis originated with the legendary king Faridun and was handed down from one king to another till Khusro Parviz reconstructed it, for which he employed artisans from Rome, that is Turkey, China, Makran, Baghdad, and Iran itself. The Takhtis stood in or beside a garden and seems to have had the form of a gigantic platform covered with golden plaques ornamented with turquoise. A different carpet was laid on it every morning. Then Ferdowsi further mentions a large golden cloth, also referred to as carpet, which was made by a Chinese artisan who presented it to the king on the occasion of Nowruz. And this carpet was a map of the heaven, which showed Saturn, Mars, the Sun, Jupiter, Venus, Mercury, and the Moon, the seven climes, and the figures of the nobles of Fars and Rome. It was all woven in gold. Now the German scholar, Sophia Dorsey was not the only one to write about the throne and carpets. Apache reports vary. And the German scholar Ernst Herzfeld, who tried to reconcile the varying descriptions, suggested that in later thinking, different Sasanian objects, such as throne, astronomical art clock, and carpets were merged. What Humayun took from this account of the royal devices of the ancients was the idea of a large carpet with representations of the planets spread out on a platform. In the planetary colors, ideas attributed to ancient Iran as transmitted through classic Persian and Indo-Persian literature served as an inspiration. Because Nizami narrates the tale of the Sasanian king Bahramgur, which forms part of his quintet of the Hamsa, and also the Indian poet Amehusro Dihlavi in his Hashbihisht followed Nizami with his version of the Hamsa. In both versions, Humayun famously visits, Bahramgur visits each of his seven princesses on different days of the week in their respective pavilions, which have the planetary color of the day, and he chooses the color of his dress also accordingly. For the Indian historian Ferishta, the Bajra's adoption of planetary colors, meaning Humayun's adoption of planetary colors in his court costume and also in the carpet of mirth, evoked such strong associations with Bahramgur that he modeled his brief description of the invention on the pavilions of Bahramgur. He wrongly said that Humayun built seven audience halls named after the planets, and that the furniture and paintings in each and the dresses of the household attendants bore a symbolic emblematic of the respective planet. Now it testifies to Humayun's creativity and imagination that he looked back to the glorious musical and historical Shahnameh makings, which were ever alive in the literature of Muslim courts with an orientation towards Persianate culture, for inspiration to present himself as a sun king and as a leader of the planets, namely his nobles, and to give the carpets a highly modern expression of a scientific diagram, the Ptolemaic concept of the cosmos, which was the state of the astronomical knowledge of his time. This marriage of allegory with science laid down a pattern of Mughal myths, which, so submerged during the reign of his son Akbar, was to reappear in a new form under his grandson Jahangir, who put science, like here this terrestrial mapped globe, into the service of allegory to have represented himself as a universal king. In a previous article, this is to conclude, I suggested to see in the Mughal Bajras the true heirs of musical ancient Persian kingship. Thank you.
That was terrific. Thank you very, very much. I very much enjoyed that. I want to thank you very, very much for a wonderful talk. There's a lot of people out there who are looking forward to reading the book. And I am myself, especially on the Shi'i angle, to pursue that a little bit more. That sounds really fascinating there. But I want to thank you very much. And I want to bid you all a very good evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you.